Okay, we move to the final item of business, and the final item of business is a member's business debate on motion 11073 in the name of Ben McPherson on enhancing Scottish football. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd encourage members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Ben McPherson to open the debate around 7 minutes. Mr. McPherson.
Deputy Presiding Officer, for over 150 years, as a country, we have observed, participated in and experienced the power of football in all the ways that manifests itself, good and bad. We've seen football's power to unite, from bringing us together as a nation, to bringing together communities around their local clubs, to bringing together MSPs today from all parties behind this motion for debate. And I thank colleagues for their interest and support. Many of us in Scotland have felt the power of the Hampden Roar, the excitement of the build-up to a big game, fans singing in unison, and the rousing of stadiums buzzing with energy in cities and towns across the country. The emotion and entertainment, win, lose or draw, whether spectating or playing. As a player back in the day, like most people who've put on a pair of boots and a pair of goalkeeper gloves, along with a deputy presiding officer, for me, football gave me joy, discipline, connection and direction. Football's taken me to places I would never have gone to otherwise. It's introduced me to people who've positively influenced my life. It's made me a better person. Yes, sometimes football does contribute to negative aspects of our society and the human condition. Hatred, abuse, violence, division, misogyny, racism, sectarianism. We must be honest that these are still present in football settings. But we must also take heart from the progress that has been made in recent decades to tackle these issues, and that footballing organisations have played a proactive, positive and effective role in changing social attitudes. There are still improvements to make, especially in my view when it comes to some over-competitiveness and bad touchline behaviour in youth football. And what's more, some stadium chatter and chanting is still totally unacceptable. On these issues and others, there are still improvements to make, but overall we should feel energised by the power of football to create and encourage positive social change and as a source of substantial individual and community benefit, especially in relation to physical and mental well-being. Last year we recognised all of this with a parliamentary reception and another debate, and in my constituency I see the positive power of football every week, whether it's delivered by the SFA's charity partner Street Soccer Scotland, or Spartans FC and their community foundation in North Edinburgh, or Hibernian FC and their community foundation in Leith, or Craig Royston, Civil Service Strollers, Leith Athletic, and all the smaller clubs that make such a positive difference week in, week out in our communities. Presiding Officer, let's pay tribute to all those involved in local football activities across Scotland, the staff and volunteers. It is those coaches, referees, teachers and parents that create enjoyable opportunities for others to play and help start professional players' careers. Similarly, let's pay tribute to those involved in running the SFA, Scottish Women's Premier League, SPFL and SPFL Trust. It is the commitment of everyone involved in both playing and organising Scottish football that has led us to the current strong position we're in today. In the women's game, this has manifested in increasing success, profile and participation, particularly since the brilliant and memorable Scotland performances in the FIFA Women's World Cup in 2019. And in the men's game, we are, of course, experiencing an incredibly successful period for the national team. As fans, we're all looking forward to the Euros in Germany this summer. Presiding Officer, whether it's the national team or local clubs, the importance of fans in generating and realising the power of football cannot be underestimated. Because while great players make magic happen on the pitch, it is the high level of participation by supporters and the commitment of supporters' groups that make football stand out as our most important and popular sport. Fans are the lifeblood of football as a major cultural industry in our country. As well as specific clubs' supporters' groups, there are, of course, a number of national supporters' groups, including Supporters Direct Scotland and the Scotland Supporters Club, of which I am a proud member. And there's also the Scottish Football Supporters Association, the SFSA. As the motion notes, last year the SFSA initiated, coordinated and published a fan-led review of the game in Scotland, with a determination to seek to enhance football at all levels. I believe that this work should form part of, and I stress part of, but a meaningful part of, how we together, collectively, seek to build on the progress and achievements of Scottish football so far and make further improvements to realise even more of Scotland's footballing potential. The issues raised in the fan-led review matter to all stakeholders involved in the game. Most notably, the standout recommendation in the review report is that the governance, finance and conduct of Scottish football could benefit from independent scrutiny and, as necessary, appropriate regulation, as is being taken forward in England. Scotland's Children and Young People's Commissioner's Office has gone further in a briefing to MSPs in calling for an independent regulator with a clear focus on human rights, protection of children and ensuring decisions are made in the best interests of all involved in football. The SFSA and others argue that at the heart of their call is an aspiration for greater accountability and transparency about those running Scottish football, both nationally, the football authorities themselves, and at a club level, regarding who owns our sports teams. Presiding officer, with power comes responsibility, and football should always primarily be about public benefit, as it receives public money and support. And it could therefore be argued that all involved in football should embrace public scrutiny and measures to uphold good governance. Indeed, the SFSA argue that greater accountability would likely enhance trust among supporters, investors and stakeholders across the game and in the wider public, and propose that the current absence of thorough, fit and proper checks on companies or individuals purchasing Scottish football clubs is not an optimal situation nor a desirable one. On the other hand, the footballing bodies have recently stated that an independent football regulator is not relevant in a Scottish context and would be an unnecessary layer of bureaucracy and cost in their view. So, there are different perspectives to consider. How do we move forward? As the legislation progresses in England, I think it would probably be prudent to collaboratively, openly and robustly consider the issues here in Scotland and how to improve and progress our national game, including safeguarding and future-proofing it. In that spirit, I wish to conclude by calling on the Scottish Government to seriously consider formally consulting on the various contemporary matters pertaining to Scottish football, including the possibility of establishing an independent regulator in the coming years, and whether this would be something appropriate and beneficial. And furthermore, building on the work of this Parliament's cross-party group on football, of which I am a member, I urge the Government to help facilitate a roundtable discussion on how football in our country can further prosper and progress, and establish a working group of all relevant and appropriate stakeholders to meet similarly on a periodic basis. There is much to be positive about Scottish football, but as most people involved in football would say in a post-match interview, there's always room for improvement. So let's work together on that. I look forward to hearing the thoughts of colleagues in the rest of today's debate and to further dialogue between everyone who cares about the beautiful game and its power in our local communities and our country as a whole.
Thank you very much, Mr McPherson. We now move to the open debate. I call first Douglas Ross, to be followed by Fulton McGregor at around 4 minutes.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I congratulate Ben McPherson for securing this debate and for his very well-informed and speech that I agreed with. Could I also remind the Chamber of my register of interest as a football referee with the Scottish FA? A couple of points that I picked up from Ben McPherson's speech there. I didn't realise, given the clubs in his own constituency have been the clubs I've been involved in the last couple of weeks, officiating Hibs when they played Forfar in the Scottish Cup and just last Saturday at Spartan v Clyde. He also mentioned that the Hampden Roar that will be known to many of us in this chamber. It was certainly known to me when I fell over my own feet and tripped up at the 2018 Scottish Cup final. But there are great memories, not that one, but there are great memories by so many of us who are involved in football at whatever level, which is why I really welcome the work by the Scottish Football Supporters Association in an extensive effort to get to the root of some of the issues they have identified within Scottish football and others have identified. And I think the series of recommendations, 15 recommendations that we see on page 15 of the report, shows there is a lot that hopefully the government can look at, the governing body can look at, and indeed fans of all teams and none, because Scottish football is going through a great era at the moment, and I was delighted to be at a reception in Westminster a few months ago to congratulate the Scottish FA on the 150th anniversary and Steve Clark and his team qualifying for Germany later this year. And again, I'm sure we will all associate ourselves with the remarks of Ben McPherson wishing the team well at the Euros, but also praising the developments we've seen across the game, be it women's football, be it disability football, be it our youth teams, and the focus that we are putting at all levels, at all parts of the country. You know, I represent the Highlands and Islands, as the Minister did, and she represents the far north. But from the far north to the south of Scotland, there are teams, there are individuals and people committed to ensuring our national game develops. And I'll give way to the Fergus Hume.
So, thank you for Mr Ross mentioning that football is not the prerogative of the Central Belt, but Inverness, County Thistle and Ross County have made their mark, not least nearly 24 years ago, presiding officer, tonight, when Celtic were famously slaughtered by Inverness Caledonian Thistle, leading to, by the journalist Paul Hickson of The Sun, possibly the greatest headline in Scottish or any football history, Super Cali go ballistic, Celtic are atrocious.
If I'd known that was the intervention, Mr Ewing, I wouldn't have allowed it. Douglas Ross.
As a match official, if I'd known that was the intervention, I wouldn't have allowed it either. But I would just say, when he mentions Ross County, that's my next game. I've got Ross County St Johnstone this weekend. The point I was trying to get across, and I think Fergus Ewing puts it very well, is that right across the country, there are teams that some started off in far lower levels. If you look at Cali, if you look at Ross County, part of the Highland League, making them their progress through the leagues, sometimes coming back down and then getting back up again. And the community feel in many of these is so important. And that's why fans are at the heart of this. And I know there is disappointment from the Scottish Football Supporters Association with the initial response from the Scottish FA. So if I can say in closing, I would associate myself with the remarks of Ben McPherson to get people round the table, to have a discussion. Now, I know the Scottish FA don't believe there needs to be an independent regulator, obviously, at the UK government. And I think Tracy Crouch's review was very positive in looking at what has happened in England. But I also think the SFSA are right to say, it's not the same problems, but it doesn't mean there are not different problems that should still be looked at in English football and Scottish football. So I think, as a minimum, I hope people can get round the table to have a discussion, to look at the work that's been done here and build on this report, because our national game is so important to all of us. It's incumbent on government, on governing bodies and on each and every one of us to ensure it develops in the years to come.
Thank you, Mr Ross. I now call Fulton McGregor to be followed by Jackie Bailey. Around 4 minutes, Mr McGregor.
Thank you. Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'd just like to say at the outset that I give my possible advance apologies, as I may need to leave before the debate finishes, to catch a train, as there's only one line currently on to Glasgow just now. I'd like to start by thanking Ben McPherson for bringing this topic to the Chamber and also declare an interest as the convener of the cross-party group on the future of football in Scotland, which he mentioned. And I want to thank all members of the group for your continued input. I'm always keen to discuss ways in which we can enhance Scottish football, as well as give credit to the hard work that goes on behind the scenes. And as others have said, we're in a big year now for Scottish football. The senior men's team will be heading to Euro 24, supported by the entire nation, as well as thousands of travelling fans as they head to Munich, Cologne, Stuttgart, and you never know, maybe even further beyond. So I would say to all the chief whips from the various parties, beware of requests in June, because I think they're coming in. I'm sure my colleagues across all parties are united in supporting investment and growth in Scottish football. We in this chamber often talk about improving wellness, physical and mental health, community engagement and social benefits. And football has the power to do all of these things. In trying to put a figure on the social benefits of football, UEFA's Social Return on Investment study, which has been widely talked about in this chamber at various times, calculated that grassroots football contributes an annual benefit of over £1.1 billion to Scotland. As convener of the cross-party group, I've seen firsthand the hard work that the SFA have done in ensuring all who want to play football can. In particular, the Football for All strategy has been excellent in removing barriers for all who wish to participate in football. As well as removing these barriers, the strategy has launched a series of initiatives to reduce discrimination across the game, and something Ben McPherson talked about, and thus bringing in a culture of inclusivity and diversity. And this commitment to inclusivity can be seen with the SFA's pioneering decision to be the first ever national FA to launch an affiliated association with specific remit for the Paragame. And furthermore, recently released statistics, which I shared in my own Twitter, or X as it's now called, revealed that there was a record number of participants in grassroots football in 2023, a whopping 161,412. And I know that colleagues across the chamber will be familiar with football pitches in their constituency being booked out on weekends and weeknights as young people learn the game. And on that note, I've raised this in here before, I do think there's a, it's not for this motion or debate, but I do think there's a bigger discussion to have here around how we make sure that there is enough adequate resources to manage this growing demand, because I think this number will grow each year. These grassroots investments have given us a great opportunity for the game to go from strength to strength in Scotland. And already, as we've talked about, the senior men's team is now in a period of sustained back-to-back qualifications for the Euros for the first time in nearly 30 years. And unfortunately, like the women's team, narrowly missing out in the most recent World Cup via the playoffs, but with sustained investment, success will come there too. And this extends to the fans. The lifeblood of the game here. Stats regularly show that per capita, there are more football fans going to games in Scotland than any other European country. And on that note, last year I was delighted to host the launch of the fan-led review of the game by the Scottish Football Supporters Association. And I'd like to thank all involved in this work. And this is, of course, the main thrust of the motion. The incredibly detailed report was the result of a mammoth effort by a volunteer team over a two-year period. The report is available online, and I would encourage members, if they've not already, to have a read of it. And it contains a number of recommendations across several aspects of the game. And we would all have different views on some of them, would agree with, and others you would have maybe different views on. And I know that other members will speak about these recommendations, but what I would say on that note is it is important that there is a wider discussion around it. Because football is very much your national support sport, Presiding Officer. It's talked about everywhere and every day, from cafes and pubs to speaker events and dedicated radio phone-ins. There's nobody can avoid football, whether you like it or not. No one body has a monopoly on what is best for our game, and that actually includes here in this Parliament. So in what will be a landmark year for the Game of Scotland, I want to use my contribution in this debate to urge the SFA, the SFSA and any other interested body to continue to work collaboratively in order to further grow the sport in Scotland. I know that all these bodies recognise that the fans are the heart of Scottish football. Let's use the report as a base to start a national discussion. And I've spoken at length about the good that is already taking place. And I know that with diligent work and a collaborative approach, we can continue on the right path to enhance Scottish football further. There might be areas of contention, Presiding Officer, such as around an independent regulator, as Ben McPherson said. And I need to be honest, I'm not sure on this one. And that's not, I don't want anybody thinking that means I'm saying I'm not for it or that I am for it. I just don't know. It goes back to what everybody's saying, but Ben McPherson and Douglas Ross have said, we need to have a wider discussion on it. We need to know the pros and the cons, and then as a nation we can come to some sort of best solution. Okay, I will close, Presiding Officer. I can see you looking at me. I will close then by reiterating my gratitude to all the hard work that the SFA and SFSA have done to develop our game in Scotland, and to wish the men's team all the very best in Germany this summer. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr McGregor. And I call Jackie Bailey to be followed by James Dorn in around 4 minutes, Ms Bailey.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Let me begin by thanking Ben McPherson for bringing this debate to the Chamber and to the Scottish Football Alliance, and Simon Barrow, who actually wrote much of the report, bringing it together. Their report, of course, on rebuilding Scottish football. I'd also like to echo members across the Chamber in recognising Scotland's national teams on their success in recent years, and I look forward to cheering on the women's team later this month, and of course the men's team in the Euros this summer. Let me also commend the Scottish Women's Premier League and its achievements, which I think speaks to the success of women's football. But the Scottish Football Supporters Association's fan-led review of football in Scotland is, I believe, a positive step towards bringing about some much-needed change in the sport. The introduction of an independent regulator to scrutinise governance, finance and transparency should be considered to give fans a much louder voice and ensure good governance in the game. Because on some occasions we know that clubs in Scotland are bought by business people without any real interest in benefiting the communities and supporters the teams actually belong to. Take Dumbarton Football Club in my own constituency. The Sun Supporters Trust have been instrumental in supporting the club over the years and voicing community concerns around ownership of the club. Dumbarton Football Club was purchased by Cognitive Capital in May 2021, a Norwegian investment group that said they planned to turn the team into a stable championship club. They also made claims that there would be a revival of multi-million pound plans for a new stadium at Young's Farm in Renton, moving the club from its existing ground to realise the ground for, guess what, upmarket housing development. There were real concerns about the future of the club itself and whether this was a case of asset stripping. Dumbarton Football Club is without doubt an iconic club. Stevie Farrell is a great manager. The team have huge potential. But it is also one of the oldest in Scotland and last year celebrated its 150th anniversary. But many believe that that strong reputation has piqued the interest of people who don't represent the interests and the future of the club and indeed the local community. Indeed, even more believe that the value of the land for residential development at the foot of Dumbarton Castle might be the underlying motivation. The Sun Supporters Trust tell me that for nearly two decades, Dumbarton Football Club has been in the hands of owners whose primary interest appears to be land and property deals, who have frequently failed to deliver resources that were promised to the club and who have reportedly stalled possible community development because of a get-rich pipe dream. Instead of treating clubs like Dumbarton Football Club with the respect that they deserve, they've been treated like development opportunities to get rich quick. That's an issue that doesn't just affect clubs in Scotland. Across the UK, clubs in England and Wales have been snapped up by multimillionaires. Sometimes it hasn't worked well and we've seen managed decline, steamrolling over the wishes of fans and taking the heart out of the sport that we all love. Proposals for greater scrutiny are, we've already heard, currently being brought forward for the rest of the UK, which is positive. But we must ensure, likewise, the regulation of Scottish football so that we are not left behind. We must come together for our communities and clubs to guarantee that public interest is at the forefront of football ownership, that Scottish football is run for the benefit of the people, and that accountability can flourish. Club management structures should not be left to mark their own homework any longer. We need to take this opportunity to bring Scottish football back to the fans and the communities that these teams belong to and to protect the future of Scottish football and clubs like Dumbarton Football Club.
Thank you, Ms Bailey. Just slightly disappointed you failed to mention Dumbarton Football Club hosting the Scottish Parliament football team, no doubt a highlight in their recent history. I now call James Dornan to be followed by Graeme Simpson. Around 4 minutes, Mr Dornan.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And may I raise a point of order on the outrageous intervention by my colleague, Fergus Ewing?
That's not a point of order, but I entirely agree with you, Mr Dornan.
Yeah, there's no place for that sort of language in this place. But on a more serious note, thanks to Ben McPherson for bringing this motion forward for debate. A huge thank you to Paul Goodwin, Simon Barrow and all the others at the SFSA for the magnificent report they produced. I must also mention Scott Robertson, the indefatigable Willie Smith of Real Grassroots, for their courage, determination and patience in bringing the protection of Scotland's young players to the forefront of public awareness by using the Parliament's Petitions Committee. I've been involved in one way or another in football for around 65 years, as a kid and then young man playing for fun, then 20 years as a coach, manager, strip washer and general dog's body, as anyone who has ever run a football club will testify, that's your roles. During these 65 years, I've seen and embraced the joy football can bring to all its participants, and that's why I'm so happy to be taking part in this debate. When I became an MSP, one of the things I was hoping to achieve was the cleaning up of the murkier aspects of the beautiful game here in Scotland, from sectarianism and racism to the horrific and far too widespread historic abuse of young lads playing football. I strongly supported the OBFA and attempted to bring in a members' bill to enact strict liability, making the club responsible for the behaviour of their own supporters. At every step of that journey, I was met with obstruction and an unwillingness to let anything upset the status quo. This came, as expected, from the two biggest clubs in Scotland, who'd most to lose, of course, but even more so when I spoke to the SFA or SPFL. Nothing to see here was the cry. When I asked for any kind of statistics to back up the nothing to do with us Gov statements, unsurprisingly, there was none available. I was going to say the SFA must have been taking lessons from the Mafia and the importance of a Merta, but I suspect it was the other way around. But I mainly want to talk about the disregard the SFA have shown to the vast majority of participants in Scottish football and the complete lack of transparency around their funding and how taxpayers' money is being spent and why an independent regulator is not just desired for Scottish football, but required for it. The hierarchy of Scottish football fear an independent regulator, one that could demand certain standards be upheld, for example, a fit and proper ownership requirement, a clear paper trail for all spending of the public's monies, particularly how it reaches or benefits our youth football, and serious attempts at bringing an end to sectarian and racist behaviour, which is simply ignored on a weekly basis in Scotland. And the reason they oppose it is based on their complete unwillingness to give up control and or upset the big two. If you ask the SFA, they will tell you they're a members-run organisation. But what they won't tell you is that the system's created in such a way that the members who run it, number two, and we all know who they are, their contempt for Parliament, most of the clubs they represent, and the grassroots that ensures that football continues to flourish in Scotland is not a new thing. When researching for this debate, I came across questions asked in 2019 of the then Justice Minister, Humza Yousaf, by myself, and a Mr. Liam MacArthur. The questions were about the reporting of sectarian behaviour by official observers. They point blank refused to hand over this information, extremely important though it was, before relenting by agreeing to hand over the information on the proviso that it was never put in the public domain. Let me assure you this, the people at the top of the tree in Scottish football do not have the interests of the ordinary supporter in mind. Just recently, the SFA chief executive suggested that the fans need to be educated. How very patronising and typically arrogant, Mr. Maxwell. Their primary interest is to ensure they stay on top of the well-paid pyramid of Scottish football and that no one nor body, even such an august one as the Scottish Parliament, shall get in their way. An independent regulator, someone with no vested interest except for the good of Scottish football, is their worst nightmare. So I urge the Minister to please support an independent regulator for Scottish football, to support our young players, the standard of ownership in our clubs, and to help Scotland finally get rid of the scourge of sectarianism from our terraces. The vast majority of Scottish football people will thank you for it. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Dornan. I now call Graeme Simpson to be followed by Gillian Mackay. Around 4 minutes, Mr. Simpson.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I also start by congratulating Ben McPherson, and in fact thanking him for bringing this debate to the Chamber, because it's long overdue, I think. And it has actually, the very fact that we're having this debate has sparked a debate. And unfortunately, what I'm seeing is already have entrenched positions between what I would describe as a fan-led group, which produced this excellent paper, and the Scottish football establishment. So what is football? I mean, it has to be more than just a business, I think. It's more than just, you know, paying to go to a game and go and, you know, cheer on your team and go home and that's it. It has to be more than that. Football is for all of us, I think. And it's about our heritage. And that heritage can be passed down the families, can be passed from father or mother to son or daughter. You will find that generations of families will support the same team wherever they live. And that's a good thing. So football matters to people in this country. So it's not just a business. It's really important. So I hope that this can be the start of a discussion that can lead to some change. Now, there's been talk of what's happening in England. There were plans for an independent regulator outlined in the King's Speech in November. This followed a fans-led review chaired by Tracy Crouch, which said that a regulator was necessary. And, of course, we've had a similar review in this paper. And I can sense the frustration throughout the paper. It does say, and I think that it's right to say, that football is full of vested interests. And it does agree that there should be a regulator. I just want to go through some of what's happening in England, because I don't agree with all of it, but I think it's worth knowing what's in there. The regulator will have three specific primary duties. Club sustainability, that's the financial sustainability of individual clubs, obviously. Systemic stability, that's the overall stability of the football pyramid. And cultural heritage, protecting the heritage of football clubs that matter most to fans. The regulator will operate a licensing system where clubs will need a license to operate as professional football clubs. It will establish a compulsory football club corporate governance code, and that will be applied proportionately with regard to the size, league and complexity of the club's business model. The regulator will establish new tests for prospective owners and directors of football clubs. That aims to avoid any more unsuitable custodians causing or contributing to problems at clubs and risking harm to fans. The regulator will implement a minimum standard of fan engagement. It will ensure clubs have a framework in place to regularly meet a representative group of fans to discuss key matters at the club and other issues of interest to supporters. Now, I'm a little bit wary of that one, I must be honest, because it depends on who you class as a representative group. I've seen groups of fans claiming to speak for every supporter of a club when they demonstrably do not. The regulator will also add and reinforce existing protections around club heritage. There is more. Now, can I thank the Scottish Football Association, the Scottish Professional Football League, the Scottish Women's Football League and the SPFL Trust for their joint letter in which they rightly point out all the positives in the game here in Scotland, but they reject the need for a regulator. They're being defensive. They don't need to be. As I said at the start, this debate today has at least sparked a debate. That's a good thing. So the football establishment, of which Douglas Ross is a member, and I'm glad he didn't fall into line behind that letter, they need to come to the table as well. So I think I would like the Minister, when she concludes, to at least agree that that kind of discussion is necessary. It should be led by the government, I think, and we can do things in this Parliament because the beautiful game belongs to us all. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Simpson. Before calling the next speaker, I'm conscious of the number of members who still want to participate in the debate, so I'm minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 8.14.3 to extend the debate by up to 30 minutes, and I invite Mr. McPherson to move such a motion.
Formally moved. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you. Are we all agreed that the debate should be extended by up to 30 minutes?
Yes.
Excellent. Thank you very much. And we move into extra time. And I call Gillian Mackay to be followed by Neil Bibby. Around 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I too would like to thank Ben McPherson for bringing this debate to the Chamber and thank the SFSA for coordinating and publishing a fan-led review of the game in Scotland. Before getting into the detail of this report and the much-needed steps that I believe we could and should take to enhance Scottish football, I believe it's vitally important, as others have said, to highlight the fantastic work already being carried out by football clubs and their supporters across Scotland, and to celebrate the positive impact that football has had on this country in recent years. As others have highlighted, we should welcome the brilliant work of our senior teams. Steve Clark and his team have managed to lift the mood of the nation and bringing us a sense of hope in the game that was missing for many years. I wish the national team all the best in Germany this summer, and I'm sure we'll all be cheering you on with every kick of the ball. Our women's game continues to go from strength to strength. In the Premier League last season, the title race went down to the very last game of the season with three teams within touching distance of the trophy, with Glasgow City coming out on top, much to the disappointment of Celtic and Rangers. We witnessed record crowds at various grounds and we saw the first women's ties played at Celtic Park and Ibrox. Long may this continue. We do, however, need to tackle the ongoing issues that women's football is facing. In recent months, we've seen a sustained amount of abuse towards women commentators and pundits. This has to stop, and there is a duty on all of us to call this out where and when we see it. Alex Scott is one of those who has had such behaviour targeted at her, and I hope that a quote she gave in the wake of the abuse will resonate with many as to how far we still have to go in changing culture, but how important representation is. And I quote, "To all the women in football, in front of the camera or behind it, to the players on the pitch, to everyone who attends games, keep being the role models that you continue to be to all those young girls that are told, no, you can't. Football is a better place with all of us in it." In my Central Scotland region, clubs like Motherwell, Falkirk and Stenismuir continue to lead their way in their local communities, delivering classes that deliver health, well-being and social benefits. I'm constantly impressed by the phenomenal work these clubs do through their community foundations or trusts. The Scottish Greens believe that our national team is for all of us, but especially in this cost of living crisis, far too many people are being priced out of our beautiful game. If we want children to look up to our athletes or to be inspired by them, then they need to be able to see both the men's and women's teams in action. That's why I have been calling on the SFA to work with broadcasters to ensure that Scotland international fixtures are placed on free-to-view TV channels. The team has done the nation proud, but due to the games only being shown on subscription services, not everybody was able to experience it live, and this must change. There are fundamentals that need to change in Scottish football. We must look at fairer distribution of resources, better marketing our game in order to attract further ethical investment, investment that doesn't include health-harming products or gambling, and for the game to be more accessible, especially to those who can least afford it, with a particular emphasis on tackling inequalities as a barrier to participation. We've such a passionate supporter base here in Scotland, and it's vital that we recognise that fans are the lifeblood of our game and a key source of revenue. We must ensure fans can have an ownership stake and a strong voice in how their clubs are run, like Motherwell and Falkirk in my region, and we must ensure that these same fans have a strong input into how the game is structured and governed. I echo the views from supporters' organisations that transparency, good governance and the oversight that this culturally important industry needs is very much dependent on having an independent regulator. Drawing on lessons from the new independent regulator for English football, new owners and directors tests for clubs should be established by replacing the existing procedures and ensuring that only good potential custodians and qualified directors can run these vital assets. We also need to look at the appointment of the president of the SFA, and I believe it should be removed and replaced with a fair voting structure whereby both clubs and season ticket holders can vote for nominated candidates from both inside and outside football. Fans contribute over 50% of the revenue to our game. This should be recognised in order to support a positive culture change across the game and to bring an additional focus on football as Scotland's national sport and showcase it to the world as a progressive, democratic, attractive and not afraid to do things differently.
Thank you, Ms Mackay. I now call Neil Bibby to be followed by Jim Fairley, around 4 minutes. Mr Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome this debate and the publication of the fan-led review by the Scottish Football Supporters Association. I thank Ben McPherson for securing this debate. As I've said previously, football is not just a sport in Scotland. It's woven into the very fabric of our society. But as much as we celebrate the force for football can be, we should also debate what more we can do to support it and, if necessary, reform it. Just because football has been central to the life of our communities over the last century and a half does not mean it will always be the case. I'm sure we could all talk at length, and we have done so far, about the positive impact football clubs have in our communities. The Street Stuff initiative, partnered by St Mirren, for example, my own region, is an excellent example. But this report highlights a series of concerns many fans have about governance issues in the game. Concerns about vested interests, decisions being made behind closed doors, and concerns about a lack of stakeholder engagement. As Jockstein said, football without fans is nothing. There's widespread concern that football authorities don't do enough to consult fans and seek the views of fans on important decisions. And football, of course, would be nothing without the players, so we need to see a greater say for fans, but also players too, and their union, the PFA Scotland. On financial governance, the SPFL and SFA have pointed out there's not been a financial insolvency involving a Scottish club in over a decade, but we know there were significant cases prior to that involving Rangers and other clubs. My concern is just because it hasn't happened over the last 10 years doesn't mean it cannot happen again. So we must ensure there are adequate safeguards and tests in place to ensure those owning football clubs are fit, proper and capable to do so. And Jackie Bailey has rightly articulated concerns in relation to Dumbarton Football Club. Presiding Officer, I think it's also vital to take the views from the Children's Commissioner extremely seriously. They explain that children continue to be viewed as economic assets by the Scottish football clubs and authorities, and that specific legislation is still needed to close gaps in domestic law which permits the commercial exploitation of children. We must ensure stronger protections are in place for our children and young people, and if this isn't addressed, it would surely make calls for an independent regulator unanswerable. So where should we go from here, Presiding Officer? I believe we need to see genuine and meaningful partnership working between fans, players, clubs, the authorities and government. The government is seeking to reset its relationships with business, and now it should seek to reset its relationships with football fans and clubs too. A reset between clubs and an end to the situation where opposition fans continue to receive limited or zero ticket allocations at away games should also happen. I thank the SPFL, SWPL and SFA for their briefing and the engagement I've had with them. I understand they don't support an independent regulator, but to justify that position, I would like to see more from them about what they intend to do to address the issues we are discussing today. And I would support the suggestion of a round table to discuss that. Finally, we need to see far more from the Scottish Government. A serious piece of work was published in June, and 7 months later, we still have not had a detailed response from the Scottish Government to the review and its 23 recommendations. Presiding Officer, as we know and has been mentioned, the UK Government commissioned its own fan-led review in 2021. I believe the Minister should take the lead on this, and if the Minister is not minded to introduce an independent regulator on the basis of this fan-led review, then the Minister should consider initiating its own fan-led review and possibly a player-led review involving the views of players to look at the future of the men's and women's games, to address the concerns that exist, to help make the changes that are needed and to ensure our national game can have a positive future and be a force for good for many years to come.
Thank you, Mr. Bibby. I now call Jim Fairley, followed by Richard Leonard, around 4 minutes. Mr. Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd also like to thank Ben McPherson for bringing forward this important debate, and I totally concur with him that the important role football plays in our communities and in Scottish society. Now, I'm going to focus on the benefits that I've seen firsthand that football brings in my own constituency, and it affirms the sentiment that Scottish football is a force for good in our culture and wider society. One of the things I've enjoyed immensely since being elected is getting out and about and meeting with all the fantastic community groups that operate across my Perthshire South and Kinrossshire constituency. As a football fan myself, I was delighted to be invited along to present the Friendship Cup at Donaldson Park in Kinross. The Friendship Cup is a yearly trophy presented to the eventual winner of a seven-a-side tournament between under-16s and 17s from Kinross Colts and a team made up of unaccompanied child refugees from Perth and Edinburgh, consisting of boys from across the world who have settled in Scotland. It's a fantastic initiative started by club chairman Brian Kenny and treasurer John Murray, and both were inspired by the work done by Football Welcomes Refugees and sought to highlight the difficulties that unaccompanied child refugees face through the power of sport. That sort of community working together has been replicated right across my constituency, I'm certain throughout other members' constituencies, and it's not just grassroots clubs like Kinross Colts, Jeanfield Swifts or Letham Football Club, who incidentally has their home at 7 acres, where I spent hours as a boy growing up in Letham, and they even occasionally let me on as a sub, despite my limited ability. No, it's not just these clubs that are giving back to their communities. In contrast to Jackie Bailey's point, I'd quickly like to point or mention the immense credit due to the Brown family, who have owned and run St Johnstone Football Club since 1986, and run it in an impeccable manner, making them a competitive Premier League club, winning a League Cup and Scottish Cup double in the season 21-22 after taking them over in 1986 as a lowly Scottish League team and in deep financial trouble. And, Presiding Officer, I would really urge Douglas Ross not to hold against the Perth Saints this week when he's officiating, just because they're in my constituency. The Perth Saints established the St Johnstone Community Trust, better known as Saints in the Community. They do some brilliant work and prove that football has numerous social benefits, improving self-esteem, inspiring children and young people, promoting well-being and healthy lifestyles and contributing to social inclusion. Saints in the Community runs several community football projects which seek to provide football and other sporting activities for kids and young people with a view to increasing the numbers playing and to create a pathway from grassroots to excellence, creating the footballing greats for the next generation. And alongside that important work, they also run a number of community projects with the themes of wellbeing and social inclusion at their heart. Saints work with Show Racism the Red Card and deliver a two-hour session at schools across Perth and Grenos to promote the message that racism has no place in football. They also deliver Football Memories Project, which uses football and footballing memories and is aimed at helping people of all ages who would benefit from social interaction, for example, those living in isolation or with a condition such as dementia or recovering from a stroke. Lastly, Presiding Officer, you cannot attend the game at McDermott Park without seeing the volunteers from Saints Fans Supporting food banks, whose motto is "Hunger doesn't wear club colours." That should resonate with members across the chamber. No matter the weather, they are out every game taking in donations for the local food bank. Football makes many valuable contributions to our society, and I would agree with Ben McPherson that we must further strengthen and develop this for the benefit of all our constituents. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Fairley. And I call the final speaker in the open debate, Richard Leonard, around 4 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I refer members to my register of interest? I'm the convener of the PFA Scotland Parliamentary Interest Group. And can I begin by thanking Ben McPherson for leading this important debate on the state and on the future of Scottish football? I have to say that anyone who witnessed the Chief Executive of the Scottish Football Association giving evidence to this Parliament just last month would have seen an organisation seemingly in denial. Ian Maxwell claimed that the Scottish game does not have the same financial failings as the game in England. Well, I'm bound to ask, what about Gretna in 2008? What about Glasgow Rangers in 2012? What about Dunfermline in 2013? And this is not just historical. What about in the last few days, when Edinburgh City had 6 points deducted by the SPFL for failing to pay its players and its debtors? The SFA's view that there is no need for reform, no need for transparency, no need for regulation, that in Ian Maxwell's own words to this Parliament, the governance in the game is robust, is to ignore not only the findings of the report we are discussing tonight, it is to ignore the objective facts. Whether it's the introduction of a regulator or the reform of the present governance framework, football in Scotland badly needs an age of enlightenment. We need the involvement of players and their union, fans and their representative organisations, not just through a consultation, but through active participation. And whether these are considered to be long-term or short-term reforms, the SFA has to accept that reforms are needed, and the beginning has to be made now. But there is something else which the SFA appears to be in denial about too, and that is the treatment of children and young people in our professional football game. Now, I accept that there have been some modest changes made, not least because of the pressure applied by those determined petitioners who drove those demands going back years through this Parliament's Public Petitions Committee. But the restriction of free movement, the denial of basic human rights to children and young people who are contracted or are even in the SFA's own terms party to enforceable documents, is still a widespread practice, with the result that if you are aged between 11 and 14 years old, that means you can be held unable to move to another club for a year. If you are 15 years or older at one of the so-called 9 elite football clubs, you can be prevented from moving to another club for 2 years. There is, to use the words of the Office of the Commissioner for Children and Young People, I quote, a systematic power imbalance. Young footballers, child footballers, are treated as commodities at best, as slave labour at worst, denied a freedom to move clubs and to simply play football. This not only throttles the development of those young people, it throttles the development of the game as well. And so I'm bound to ask the Minister, When are you going to act? Where is the urgency? These young people are only 11 once, 13 once, 15 once. So it's no good coming back in 2 years' time saying that we've had another review, because by then it will be too late for this generation. It is the duty of government, even a nationalist government, to deal not just with a territory, not just with a domain, but to build and sustain a society. So it is time for a period of enlightenment, for an era of democratic reform to sweep through the governance and control of Scottish football, and I can't think of a better place to start than with the rights and freedoms of our children and young people, and I can't think of a better time to start than now.
Thank you very much, Mr. Leonard. And I now invite Marie Todd to respond to the debate minister. Around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Football is a subject which many of us in this chamber and indeed right across the country clearly feel very passionate about. And we've heard many contributions this afternoon which demonstrate just how much football means to people. Our national game continues to grow in popularity and reach wider audiences, and I know that the Scottish FA is committed to continuing to grow and develop the game. We continue to work closely with them on this, and their briefing note to MSPs was extremely helpful in setting out what they are doing in a wide range of areas. Supporters, though, are the lifeblood of the game, and it's vital that their role is recognised. The Scottish Government recognises this, and we enjoy positive relationships with the national fans organisations, Supporters Direct Scotland and the Scottish Football Supporters Association. We believe fans should be able to have real influence on the game as a whole and on the future of the clubs that they love and support. And that's why last May we launched the Fan Bank, which is intended to support organised fan groups to become more involved in the ownership of their club, ensuring that interests are represented on clubs' boards and protecting those clubs for generations to come. The Fan Bank will make a positive change to football and help to put real power in the hands of supporters in the local community. Falkirk Supporters Society was the first recipient of a loan from the Fan Bank, with £350,000 enabling them to increase their shareholding so that they and other small shareholders now have the protection of owning a third of the club. And that investment has in turn supported the club in renewing its pitch for this season and investing in the club's development. We've also had discussions with a number of other supporters groups about potential bids into the Fan Bank, and I'm really glad that this initiative is proving so popular with football fans. Now, today's debate has been inspired by the review of Scottish football launched in June last year by the Scottish Football Alliance and the Scottish Football Supporters Association. The review covers a very wide range of issues, and many of them around formations of the leagues or division of prize money, for example, while of interest, are simply not for the Scottish Government to comment on. There are elements of it, of course, which we fully endorse. For example, that the game be accessible and welcoming to everyone, with a particular emphasis on tackling inequalities as a barrier to participation. On Monday, I spoke at a UNESCO and UEFA event at Hampden on social outcomes contracting, and I reflected on my visit to the Amputee Football Nations League in Fife last year, which saw Scotland qualify for the finals in France this June. And, oh my goodness, how truly inspiring it was to see our amputee athletes competing at an international level. Scottish Para Football is doing outstanding work in promoting a wide range of parallel ways to engage in the game. Now, turning back to the review, the headline proposal is clearly the call for an independent regulator. It's certainly an interesting one. The fan-led review in England emerged from a particular set of circumstances, and the recommendation that a regulator be set up was to address particular challenges to the sustainability of the English game. The football landscape in Scotland is very different, but that is not in itself an argument against the introduction of a regulator. However, The specific role of any such body would very much need to be tailored to the Scottish context, as would the funding of it. Now, I understand the regulator in England is estimated to cost around £30 million, and that's going to be funded through a levy on clubs. Whilst I would obviously expect a Scottish regulator to cost substantially less than this, the cost would still be significant in a Scottish context, and I am not clear at this stage where this could come from. So before such a big step is taken, I think it would be really useful to undertake some learning from England, which, as far as I am aware, is the only country which is currently legislating to introduce an independent regulator. I'd like to understand better how the regulator is planning to operate in England, and once it's up and running, how effective it is at achieving its aims. And I will absolutely ask Scottish Government officials to engage with the UK Government on this. Finally, I would also wish to consider whether any such regulator, certainly.
Graeme Simpson.
Can I thank the Minister for taking the intervention? I'm listening very carefully to what she's saying. So she appears to be saying she wants to wait for the regulator to be set up in England and then wait to see how it operates before doing anything. How long does she expect that to take? I mean, to me, that could take several years. Is she not prepared to at least start discussions right now?
Minister, and could you perhaps move the phone away from the microphone? I think it's picking things up.
Certainly. I'm more than happy to talk about what I do plan to do in the fullness of time. I would want to consider whether any such regulator would operate across sports governing bodies rather than being specifically about football. One would find it hard to argue with the calls for accountability, transparency and responsibility in football, but these are traits that I think any and all of our sports governing bodies should demonstrate. Now, I know that Sport Scotland works with sports governing bodies to ensure effective financial management, organisational stability, leadership and planning and policy implementation, and they should certainly be part of this discussion. So, in summary, today, I cannot commit to establishing an independent regulator. A lot of work needs to be done to understand how that would operate, how it would be appointed and funded, and what the specific role would be, and whether there are other ways to achieve the agreed outcomes short of establishing a new body. But equally, I'm in my closing at the moment, equally, the door is not by any means closed on this. And if a strong case can be made as to why it was necessary and why other measures short of regulation couldn't be implemented, which addressed some of the issues raised, I am absolutely content to continue the conversation. I'm more than happy to host a roundtable discussion on this, as been suggested. I will ask my officials to take this forward with Ben McPherson. We've heard this afternoon what football means to people and what it means to fans to support their club and their country. Scotland's had a long love affair with the game. We found it, and it still holds a very special place in our hearts. And as Minister for Sport, I see my role as helping sport to flourish, and I'm, of course, very happy to work with partners to achieve this. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.